if we're talking about the mid-19th century and this path toward civil war, there really are two names, and it's John C. Calhoun and Jefferson Davis. So let's talk a little bit about Calhoun's origins. Who is this guy? Where does he come from? And how does he begin to craft his philosophy?
One of the things that's really important to remember about Calhoun is that he is a really transitional figure in our country. We go from this period of the founders who are creating the country, deciding its initial steps of what it's going to mean, dealing with our initial problems, but they're leaving the stage largely by the time Calhoun comes on.
One of the things I always think about when I think of John C. Calhoun is an interesting comment that Andrew Jackson made later on. Jackson said that he had two great regrets in life, and one was that he hadn't shot Henry Clay, and the other one is that he hadn't hanged John C. Calhoun. Calhoun is Jackson's vice president during the nullification crisis, which is when South Carolina decided that it could nullify or reject federal law. And it's so easy to forget that 30 years before the American Civil War, there was a president of the United States who was from Tennessee, who was a slave owner, who rejected outright this states' rights first mantra, which is what Calhoun was putting forth, that the Supremacy Clause in the Constitution really didn't apply. And the states didn't just have a paramount right, they had the supreme right to reject this. So Andrew Jackson says, no, you don't. And Calhoun takes this incredible position. He resigns as Vice President of the United States of America, believing that he could have more power to really promote his position as a senator. Within 4 years, there's a gag rule in the House of Representatives that prevents the abolition of slavery, even the mere discussion of slavery, from being brought up on the floor of the People's House. And in one of these amazing moments, the same gag rule is introduced in the U.S. Senate, and it failed by one vote. And when the final die was cast and the vote wasn't in Calhoun's favor, he stormed out of the Senate. And I think Calhoun would spend the next 14 years of his life making sure that he never lost another battle again when it came to states' rights. He begins to also expand his argument, which I think harkens back to some of those early founders like Patrick Henry, who thought the Constitution was too restrictive, the federal government was overbearing from the beginning. There's some argument to be made, discounted many of the Federalist Papers. So he is an absolutist. He believes in the power of the state. But he begins to develop another argument. He begins to attack the Declaration of Independence, and he goes after the term, all men are created equal. And there's this amazing speech he gives in 1848, and he actually says, all men are not created. He doesn't just say, all men are not created equal. He then goes on to say there were only two people created. Presumably, he means Adam and Eve, because he said, according to the Bible, everyone else henceforth was born, and they are no more equal to one another than anyone else. This becomes the foundation of the movement towards secession, which is all, of course, wrapped up in the protection of slavery.
Calhoun starts to have a very vocal, strong defense of slavery. And what is interesting when you read his writings, especially late in his life, he is laying out a very logical, reasonable defense of slavery. And when you read it now, it has the rhetoric and the logic of a very solid argument, except for at its core is the idea that slaves are lesser people, that they are better off in bondage, and it is a God-ordained condition for them, and that they are not capable of governing themselves. And I think that's one of the things that is pernicious about Calhoun, is that he provides kind of a logical defense of slavery. And if you're inclined to defend slavery, there's a very smart guy who's showing you how to do it.
One of the things that's so easy to do is to discount these people as either racists or bigots, or they're just prejudiced, and we just cast them aside. That oversimplifies a person like John C. Calhoun. He became a very powerful instrument of American politics. In his final moments, in the throes of the Compromise of 1850, Calhoun presents his last speech. He's so ill, he cannot speak. He is wheeled into the Senate. His speech was read, and right away, the issue of slavery comes up. I think in the first sentence, and there he sits, his eyes burning with the same fire, same power that they always had. But the torch was being passed, and it was being passed to the absolutely perfect person to carry the Calhoun mantra toward war. And that's Jefferson Davis.
You know, and Davis, he articulates a point of view that appeals to the Southern ideology in those years before the war. He says over and over again that he's an American, that he loves his country, that he thinks secession should be the last alternative. Yet he doesn't shy away from the possibility. I mean, so he sees Lincoln as a threat, right? Slavery shouldn't expand and we hope it eventually dies out. That's a threat to Southern ideology. And to him, that's something that's worthy of seceding over.
His presidency was a failed one. The South, the Confederacy, had lost the war. But what Davis did in 1881, and he lives 8 more years, is with his memoirs, Davis plants the seeds of the Lost Cause. His legacy, and that of John C. Calhoun, is what we live with today. He was unshakable and inflexible. His message from 1850-ish until the day he died remained constant and unchanging.
And he's talking about sovereignty of the states. Over and over again, he's defending the rights of Mississippi, his rights, and that right that he's talking about is the right to own slaves.
Someone who is, let's say, defending the position of the South of the Confederacy will usually make an argument, and it's well-intentioned. Well, everyone knows that slavery is wrong. That's a flawed argument, because what that person is doing is applying our modern sensibilities. John C. Calhoun would have said that was complete and utter nonsense. John C. Calhoun not only believed that slavery was good, it was appropriate, it was constitutional and had to be protected at all costs.
And Jefferson Davis picks that up almost verbatim. Davis says the institution of slavery is the most humane relations of labor to capital which can permanently subsist between them, and the most beneficent form of government that has been applied to those who are morally and intellectually unable to take care of themselves. African slavery, as it exists in the United States, is a moral, social, and political blessing.
Those words don't change from Davis for almost 40 years, because what he starts to say around the time of Calhoun's death, he's saying it during the Compromise of 1850 discussions, is that, for example, the slave trade was, to use his words, beneficial to the African because we gave him the lighted rays of Christianity. He's still saying that in the 1880s. One of the problems that I think we have today is that some people want to continue to have this theoretical discussion about whether secession was constitutional or not. At the time of the Nullification Crisis, there was only one founder who was alive, and that was James Madison. James Madison would know a good bit about the Constitution, since he wrote most of it, and he and Alexander Hamilton, of course, were the chief architects of the Federalist Papers. He said secession was a right, but he added a very important caveat. He said arbitrary secession was not the intent. Madison put forth an argument that if a state wanted to secede, that state needed to petition the other states, and if they agreed, then that state could secede. John C. Calhoun and Jefferson Davis turn Madison's argument completely around. If we just cut to the chase, the reason that these states desired to secede was because they wanted to protect slaves. Let's not forget Jefferson Davis, as president of the Confederacy, is working under the manners of a constitution that prevented slavery from ever being abolished. Davis is captured at the end of the Civil War, and he spends going on 2 years as a prisoner. In fact, for a good bit of that time, he was shackled. I think the Pope at the time sent him a crown of thorns, as if he was suffering like Christ. So if the head of the Catholic Church was feeling sorry, it is no wonder in many ways that Davis, at that moment, he didn't have to die like Abraham Lincoln. He became a martyr.
It's really within 20 years or so that we're at the brink of civil war.
I think that John C. Calhoun and Jefferson Davis, they represented a significant portion of the white male population, not just even of the South, but of what we would later call border states, and even many areas of the North. This idea about the supremacy of the white race over the black race was not limited, obviously, just to the South. As we've talked many times, slavery may have been a Southern institution by the time of the Civil War, but this was an American problem. And Davis spent, you know, half of his life being a citizen of the United States of America,
yeah,
being a senator in the United States Senate, being the Secretary of War. So he was quintessentially American. And there also is this unrepentant side of him, the refusal to back down and admit he'd ever done anything wrong,
yeah,
which is also a bit of a rebellious spirit admired by people.
Yeah. When Davis finally finishes his memoirs, it's been a post-war project for him. It's the Rise and Fall of the Confederate Government. It comes out in 1881. On his copies, he inscribes on the opening pages a Latin phrase from the Roman philosopher and playwright Seneca. And that phrase is, prosperous and successful crime is called virtue. And that's really fascinating. That's Jefferson Davis in 1881, 20 years after the outbreak of the war. That's his perspective. And it says a lot about where he is, that he's not apologizing. He doesn't think they're wrong. And to me, that's part of the big legacy of Jefferson Davis, is that at the end of the war, he still thinks that states' rights were important, that the South had a right to secede. And he's not willing to concede that point. To him, nothing has been settled. If anything, the Union won because they had greater man and, you know, materiel. That, to me, is a closing chapter of that Civil War generation, the Calhoun ideology being transferred to Davis and Davis's generation. And then Davis's ideology post-war then gets handed down to the next generation.